Twilight to twilight, I am on my way back home. Twilight to twilight, I am on my way back home. The sun is setting and I'm looking forward to tonight. A preparation is in order for I've set apart delight. It's our delight. Twilight to twilight, I am on my way back home. May this day be yours and mine, I bow down at your throne. 6 days shall work be done, and the seventh is Shabbat, for solemn rest, for our meeting. I've been needing this most high, my Yah, my love. Twilight to twilight, I am on my way back home. Twilight to twilight, I am on my way back home to Yah.
Brothers and sisters, welcome back to the Torah Institute. And in this very special fourth episode of the Branches of Yahusha, we're going to be talking to our friend in Los Angeles, HARRIE TROTMAN. He is a fellow singer, songwriter, musician, loves Yahusha. In fact, that's his SoundCloud username, loves Yahusha. And we're going to be chatting with him tonight. So here we go. Hey, my brother.
I mean, good night.
So we're early morning for you, is it?
Yeah, a little bit. Wow, so great to be talking to you. Finally.
Yeah. Sorry I'm side on, but this will all make sense once you watch it back.
Okay, no problem.
Yeah. So you are in where are you?
Los Angeles, California.
Yeah. Is that a bedroom there or a...
Oh, it's an office.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, kind of funky wallpaper.
Wonderful. It's good to meet you, brother.
Yeah, likewise, you know. I've been watching you, you know, on YouTube and stuff, and so it's kind of surreal.
Yeah.
Hearing you in real life, I guess.
I reckon. I've been listening to your music too, I understand.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah, thanks for that in the comments.
Oh, that Twilight song is my favorite. I love it.
Oh, really? Yeah.
Yeah.
I wrote that a while ago, you know, kind of early on in my learning, and you know, just that zeal, that passion for you know, his word and his way. So.
Yeah. Oh, wonderful. So, how old are you?
I'm 24. Yeah, and as a the Romans second month,
and you're engaged to be married to Lauren.
Yeah.
And so she doesn't live near you.
Not at the moment. She's in Texas right now.
So. That's a fair way, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
So you're how far away is that from you?
I think like on Google Maps, I had to something like 20 hours driving.
Wow.
Yeah. So I can't really, you know, make that weekend trip over to her or anything like that.
Yeah. Long distance.
We'll try and visit each other off. Mm. Yeah.
Mm. So have you got any plans when you're going to get married, or is she studying, or why is she so far away?
She is working at this foster care community, and so she's basically, she committed to be a foster care parent within the community for a year, and before we decided to get married, she already made that commitment, you know. So once we made, you know, our commitment, you know, we had already known, like, okay, it's going to be a little bit tough, but, you know, of course, we care for each other a lot, you know, wanting to make that, make those plans. And so, you know, we were just willing to work through it. So it's, you know, the year's almost up, and, you know, we're excited to be close to, you know, being able to share our life together without, you know, Skype and phone calls, you know, being like our main method of communication.
So when's she coming back?
She's going to be back in July. You know.
Very exciting. And you're planning to get married then, are you?
Then in August.
Oh, beautiful. Beautiful.
Yeah.
And you've got brothers and sisters. Do you live at home, or do you live by yourself, or with mates, or how?
At the moment, I'm living at home. Got two younger brothers and a little mom and dad.
Mm. And how did you find out about Yahusha?
I found out about him. Well, my parents are actually, my dad, he's a Christian pastor of the Nazarene denomination. You know, close to Nazarene, you know, which is kind of interesting. You know, so I grew up, you know, with the word in general being taught to me. But, you know, being a pastor's son, you know, I feel like either you'll, pastor's kids, you know, tend to either, like, rebel or, you know, you're really devout, you know, kind of one of the extremes. At least my interaction with other pastor's kids. And so I naturally rebelled, you know, once I kind of, I guess around my teenage years. And I, you know, kind of was always kind of questioning the belief. And there came a time where I was put in the role of youth president, you know. So I was, you know, I had to intake a lot of the word myself and, you know, teach it. And so I was always fascinated with end time prophecy. So, you know, I tried, you know, teaching end time prophecy. The more I was reading, you know, I mostly just, like, looked at Revelation, you know. I realized, like, okay, I need to look, you know, at more scripture than that. And, you know, growing up in my dad's assembly, you know, they, you know, taught from pretty much all of New Testament. You know, Old Testament never really looked there, had any reason to, you know, or what is called the Old Testament, you know. So I read this one book. It was a Christian author. I forget the title of it now. But basically it was like, you know, going through Daniel and some of Jeremiah and, you know, books like that, you know, touching on that and how, you know, showing the connection between those books and then, you know, what was written in Revelation. So it really opened up my mind to, like, oh, well, you know, like, there's a lot, you know, the Old Testament is, like, necessary. And so a couple things in there threw me off. Like, in there they mention, in the guy, the book, the Christian author, I know the title of the book. I feel like it's going to come to me soon. It's a little early over here. But he mentioned how the days began with sunset and end with sunset, you know, originally. And, you know, that's, that, to me, I was just like, what? I never heard of that. How come I've never heard of that? Yeah. Talked about, you know, I've been in, you know, like in the denomination for, you know, all my life. And, you know, something like that, I feel like it's pretty important, you know? Mm-hmm. And so I kind of just kind of pushed me to start poking around, asking more questions. And I remember hearing that the son's name was something closer to Joshua. I remember at some point just picking it up, and I remember asking my dad, like, oh, is Messiah's name, like, his real name, like, Joshua or something? And he's like, yeah, something like that. I think at the time he told me something like Yeshua, you know, or something. And so I was like, oh, okay, you know. And, you know, kind of, and really, like, it was just there in the back of my head. After. And so there was this one conversation with just a friend of a friend at a time. And I remember he was, you know, kind of getting into the word. He was also, like, you know, just learning about things. And you know, told me like, oh, did you know that, you know, the days start with sunset? And I was like, yeah, I just learned that too. That's strange. And then he told me like, oh, did you also know that, you know, we should still be observing the Sabbath? And I was like, really, the Sabbath? Like so you mean Sunday? And he's like, no, you know, like, you know, it's part of, you know, Saturday, you know. And I was like, oh, that's weird. And so he led me to this one website. It was I think it's israeliteheritage.com, and on that site it's like their main message was that you know, people of dark color are like the true people of Israel, you know, like kind of that angle. I'm sure you've come across that, you know. Yeah. And you know, and so that was my first exposure, because they also preached that, you know, we're supposed to be Torah observant. So that was my first exposure to that. So I've gotten the site and like absorbed a lot of that, and was just like, wow, you know. And you know, I interacted with them like on Instant Messenger and like Pal Talk. You know, they would have kind of like, you know, kind of gatherings, like Shabbat gatherings, you know, there. And you know, like it was good stuff, you know. The only thing I was kind of apprehensive about that collective was like they're kind of really pushing like the race thing, you know. Like I feel like that was kind of a little bit too dominant, you know. And I feel like that's reminiscent of like, you know, the Jews of today, you know. They kind of take that role of like, oh, they're people of Israel, can't touch them, you know, they're, you know, they're anti-Semitic, you know, they can't say anything about them, you know. And I always thought like, okay, wasn't there, you know, Yahusha's blood like came and, you know, like made us all one people, a spirit people, you know, like. And so that's kind of the way that I saw things regarding the Hebrew Israelite, you know, like their angle was kind of like too racially, you know, dominant, I guess, like, you know, the view. So I kind of was like kind of veering away from that, you know. I feel like there's some truth there. And the Messiah's name, according to them, like they call him Yahushua, you know. And when, you know, of course, as the more that I went on, you know, I try to study some Hebrew, you know, like on my own and looking at the letters and stuff. And I just felt like, okay, how did they get Yahushua, you know, those sounds, you know. And it was just a desire of me to try and, you know, get to the most truth as possible, you know, like, and so as it is still now, you know, just slowly trying to sort out like, okay, this is not so much truth. Okay. You know, and just holding on to, cause you know, we're in the latter days and just so much, deception is like around, you know. I came from a Christian background, so you can imagine like all the stuff I had to be like, oh wait, I shouldn't be doing this. Oh, I see. I shouldn't be maybe eating this. Oh, okay. You know, just kind of so much.
So your parents were Christians and yet they called themselves Nazarenes, did they?
Yeah, they do. It's one of the denominations within Christianity. I've been to several like meetings, like it's like a, you know, like a district, you know,
yeah,
you know, the whole hierarchy.
So what's different about a Nazarene Christian? Do they sort of go back to the Hebrew roots a bit, do they?
I don't really know. I don't really think so, because I feel like it's kind of generally Christian, you know. Still, you know, they you know, they still have like Sunday services. They still have the bunny rabbit thing. You know, they do that. You know, all those same, you know, all the same. Trying to be careful with the words here, since I imagine some stuff is going to be online. You know, some people are really like, oh, you said that word, you know.
That's all right, mate. We get the gist of what you're saying.
So the different holidays.
Yeah, how does it feel? But so you're living in a pastor's house. How does it feel about that?
It's very trying,
yeah.
I would say, because, I mean, now this is, you know, like 2 years into, you know, my shift of belief, you know, like I kind of, you know, there was a time where I was like rebelling, and then I was kind of like coming closer, and I was kind of like, okay, you know, I'm interested, you know, and I'm soaking things in. And I actually got, you know, immersed with my dad's assembly, you know, and, you know, even at that time, you know, I remember asking my dad, like, you know, since I'm unsure about the names, can you say, like, oh, you know, I immerse you in the name of the Son, the Father and Spirit, you know, but not saying, like, actually, like, J-E-S-U-S or whatever. And at the time, it was kind of like, it's kind of weird. And I remember when he did it, I believe he still, you know, used J-E-S-U-S. You know, I love my dad. I'm not saying, trying to, you know, like, you know, why did you do that? Like, I know, I have no, you know, regret about that. But, you know, so that happened. And then, you know, the more that I learned, it bothered me. So, you know, I later became immersed in Yahusha's name. You know, I kind of pronounced his name a little bit differently, but like Yahusha, but, you know.
How do you pronounce it?
Like Yahusha, like.
Yahusha.
Yeah, just kind of soft H instead of like hard H, you know? Like,
yeah, Yahusha.
yeah, you know, like I kind of more emphasize the first syllable, Yahusha. I like kind of Yahusha, you know?
Yeah.
yeah.
Well, we'll never really know until he says who he is to us, will we?
yeah, you know. Yeah. I mean, yeah, so. Yahusha, you know, that common ground, it's fine with me.
Yeah, it's great. Wonderful. So yeah. What do you do with your days, mate? Do you work? Do you study? What do you do?
Yeah, right now I work for an after-school educational program. So, you know, I help kids with homework, and it's kind of like homework help along with, you know, kind of mentorship. And so, you know, I do that. You know, I enjoy working with kids. It's middle school kids, so they're not, you know, they're kind of almost teenagers, you know, so they're, you know, they're pretty smart kids, you know. It's kind of interesting to see how the world is affecting them, you know, kids at that age, you know, 11 to 13. But I enjoy working with them, you know, and just, you know, being a kind of a positive influence in their life.
Oh, wonderful. And you're doing gigs at night.
Yeah, I had a show last night, earlier, so, we got back, like around 12:30 my time, so, yeah, I just basically took a little nap, and then got back up, had a lot of alarms.
What time is it now for you? 4 o'clock or something?
Yeah.
Four in the morning. Oh, I appreciate it, mate.
Yeah, oh my goodness, I feel so bad about the whole webcam issue, the laptop, and then, you know, just sleeping in the night before, you know, a couple nights. So sorry about that. So
that's fine, mate. Yeah, don't worry.
Well, thank you for patience.
It'll happen when it happens.
Yeah.
Fantastic. And so you, Armadi Hush?
Armada.
Armada Hush?
Armada Hush, yeah.
Where'd that come from? That's the name of your band, brothers and sisters. You're in a band with another bloke, aren't you?
Yeah. It's just him and myself. He came up with a name, actually. I think at first we were playing with Hush Armada and just toying around with the names, and I know the meaning for him. He kind of had like a very specific meaning for it. And I like the name. I thought it sounded cool. I was like, okay, that works for me. Didn't, you know, give this a strange message. But kind of like to think that, you know, maybe the Armada, you know, it's a fleet of ships normally. But, you know, we kind of think of the masses being, you know, the Armada, you know, just this large group. And, you know, they tend to be silent about a lot of injustices that are in the world. And so, you know, kind of that kind of get that's kind of the idea of behind the name. And then in our music, you know, like we have some songs where it's talking about like love and, you know, relationships, usual things like that. Besides that, you know, like you've heard one of the songs where it's kind of like talking to the person that's sleeping, you know, like for me, like, you know, I'll write and some meanings, you know, are specific to like my belief, you know, but, you know, my friend, he's, you know, he's not he doesn't follow, doesn't have the same faith as I do, you know,
you got to be subtle.
yeah, you know, he's
throw
kind
a little
of more,
bit in there, nobody will know, but I know.
Yeah, that's exactly, you know.
Yeah.
I kind of feel like he does the same thing too, but, you know, I have to, you know, we try to,
yeah.
You know, this is more secular background, so we try to work on the middle ground, you know. I feel like maybe some people might be like, oh, you know, you're unequally yoked kind of thing. But I really feel like, you know, I prayed about the band a lot, you know, like, you know, it's been, a year. It was a year, a week ago or so that, you know, I've been playing with this guy, and, you know, I've definitely, you know, prayed about the band and stuff. And I really feel like, you know, the Father has been pushing me to continue the band, at least for now. And, you know, so, you know, working with him, you know, we've been able to make good music. You know, he is also, you know, for loving, you know, our fellow man. And, you know, he's kind of spiritually, I guess, feeling things out, you know, like,
yeah.
He's been in a band with me for a year, so he's going to hear a lot, you know, he's open to my sharing of my belief. And so, you know, we definitely have all kinds of conversation regarding philosophy and stuff like that.
Mm.
Love that guy. He's good, really good, good dude.
What's his name?
Angel.
Angel, fantastic. That's a spiritual character, isn't it? So how do you get these gigs? How do you book them, or do you have a large following of fans, or?
We've got an okay following. We got 100 or something likes on Facebook.
Fantastic.
But yeah, we tend to just, you know, search online, search around for venues that have open mics. You know, we're an acoustic duet, you know, so we like to look for events where it's kind of more like a open, like an open environment, like things, kind of street festivals, stuff like that. You know, we work really well there. Last night we worked at this was like a restaurant, kind of bar, lounge kind of thing. So yeah, we played there. We played at a couple other kind of bar type scenarios, but a lot of them are really geared towards live music being the main, you know, draw. So, you know, that's been really fun.
So is it for the joy of it, or did they pay you? Do you make any kind of good money doing this, or?
No, not yet. We're kind of, you know, building up to that. It'd be great to, we're, you know, recording a full length album on our own. You know, and since we're both working, and you know, I've got, you know, I'm doing wedding planning, half of the wedding planning, you know, from here in LA, and Lauren's doing stuff in Texas, you know, so that's kind of a strain. So, you know, there's a lot of other things that's occupying our time, but in the meantime, we're, you know, trying to record an album, and then, you know, have merchandise, you know, sell CDs and posters and things like that, trying to get that stuff together so that we can be generating, you know, some kind of income with the band. So slowly but surely, we're hoping that's, you know, doing something there. And we both, you know, believe in the cause of, you know, just bringing people to, helping people become aware of, you know, some of the stuff going on in the world, and, you know, just really just trying to, like, kind of shift mindsets, you know, away from kind of the mainstream thing, like, you know, a lot of stuff that's taught, like, in Hollywood, you know, like, we're in LA, so we see Hollywood right there, and it's kind of like the voice of Hollywood is, like, kind of really loud to us, figuratively speaking. And, you know, there's a lot of stuff that's just taught, you know, that just really hurts, you know, like, people kind of like, oh, casual sex, it's fine, have friends with benefits kind of thing. And, you know, that kind of lifestyle is actually really destructive, and we both, like, have gone through that, and, you know, so stuff like that. I mean, not just that, but that's just an example, you know, things that we like to talk about and shed light on in our music. And so,
brilliant, wonderful.
So, ask you some questions now.
It's all about you, mate. Everybody knows me. You can talk about whatever you want, mate.
Well, how's the family?
Family's great. It's actually 9:15 here, so they went to bed about an hour ago.
Oh, okay.
So, But my little daughter, she's ripping another tooth through, so she took a little while longer to get to sleep. So she needed a bit of extra attention. So,
well, what's that like, you know, being a dad?
you got to get used to it. It takes practice. For me, each child that came along sort of brought me out of myself a bit more. Like with the first child, the father really doesn't have to do anything because the mother's with the child all the time. And I wasn't that interested back then. And I love him, still love him, but I'm just saying, once the third comes along, he's sort of, I've got to step in a bit more and help. And then four and five, you know, it's just teamwork full on. So it's, it brings you out of yourself. You've got to go there, you know. And I've spent way too much time sort of on the computers the last few years. So that's why our plan is to, in a few months, hit the road in a caravan and show the kids a bit of the world, you know.
Yeah.
So, just wrap
sounds
up.
Sounds like it'll be fine.
Yeah, wrap up a bit of a body of work so people can refer to it online, and then go and just have a bit of a break and recharge the batteries. So.
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah, I feel like you do a lot. You do a lot of a lot of work online. It's really good, you know. You guys are reaching out, and yeah, it's awesome.
Well, it's amazing just to see what Yahusha's going to do next. So,
yeah.
Mm. And just as soon as a few brothers were bringing the word forward that the people should start getting to know one another so that we're connected, the body should know who the body is. So all the parts should know who they are. So I thought, well, let's start Skyping people. And, I think everybody would be really encouraged to see one another.
Yeah. It really is encouraging as someone, you know, that's kind of like, you know, just been watching from home, you know, really far away from you guys. I still, I still feel like, oh, cool. My family's out there. Like, I know they're out there. Maybe I don't talk to them, see them, get to hug them, but, you know, they're out there. So it's really, it helps.
Yeah. I mean, I know our goal is to tune into Yahusha, but, I mean, it's when you're used to coming from big assemblies and things like that, you come out and often you can just get battered around a lot. You're just like, well, they're doing it this way and they're doing it that way, and how are you supposed to do it? And, you know, unless you sit down and spend, unless you go through the Torah, you know, from cover to cover all the time, and you know, you sort of still sort of make up your mind about things. So to hear other believers' voices, you know, who sort of sound like they're sort of not too way out in this area or that area, they're sort of just sort of normal, if I can say that word. It's just, you know, not too extreme in some area or another. It's just scripture, love, you know, live your life, scripture, love, you know.
Yeah.
It's wonderful. You'll find out. You're on that road, mate. Your fiance seems lovely, what I've seen of him.
Oh, yeah. I think so. Yeah. She's got a great heart. Just a great person. Love her.
Yeah. And you're planning to live in Los Angeles?
Yes. She loves it out here. So I was like, okay, I could stand living out here some more. For a while longer.
And how did you meet her?
My dad, he used to have this guy co-pastor with him, at his assembly, and he and that co-pastor, he had a son about the same age as me, and you know, we grew up together and just really great friends, and they moved away it's about 7 years now or so. And so they came to visit, you know, I hadn't seen him since then. And so, you know, he came to visit, but his dad now is a professor at a school. So the son came along with the dad, and then the dad like brought a class with him, like it was for, I don't know, something regarding, you know, I guess urban communities or something like that. And so she was one of the students in that class, and you know, I was one of the main people, you know, hanging out with the group and showing them parts of LA, you know, stuff like that. You know, and you know, I was hanging out with my buddy, you know, at the same time, and you know, she was just the one that I, you know, got to connect with the most. You know, even after their trip, they went back home. You know, we still stayed connected, and you know, she came out here a couple more times after that, and you know, we just became really close. You know, just really great friends, you know, at first. And, you know, as time went on, actually it was I learned that she was going to be leaving for Texas for that trip, you know, and I had a feeling, you know, that after that, you know, she's a really independent spirit, you know, like, you know, she's wanted to go work in Texas, you know, away from her family, away from her friends, you know, she didn't know anyone out there, just to go and work with kids who may not have parents to love on them, you know. You know, she's kind of that person, really independent. She'll just go where she feels like there's need. And, you know, so I kind of had this, you know, feeling in my heart where I was like, it would be a tragedy to lose her, you know, like being in my life, you know. And so I began to, you know, pursue her, you know, like wanting to date her. And so, yeah, just kind of snowballed. And, you know, I've done a lot of like searching with, you know, girls and stuff like that, you know, and, you know, just, you know, trying to date people despite it. Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. Exactly. You know, I was unequally yoked most of the time, you know, and mm-hmm. just kind of trying things out. You know, I was like, oh, I kind of know that this might not work, but, you know, maybe it still will. And, you know, it just would. There'd still be something lacking, and we both have the spiritual common ground, Lauren and I, and so that is one of the main things that that drew us together and really like kind of helped us bond really well, and we just got along great as friends. So you know, just you know, once we really got to know each other and you know, began dating and just, you know, got to know each other on a deeper level, you know, like we just realized that, you know, like, yeah, I could spend the rest of my life with you. So of course it wasn't like, yeah, like that, but yeah, just she's the one, you know, and just the way that we came together and a lot of things floating around there, we just felt like, you know, maybe a little bit apart this time. So yeah.
Oh, wonderful. How did she find out about you? Did you tell her?
Yeah, I did. Before we were dating, you know, I was, you know, coming into learning about these things. And so I was like, oh, this is some of the stuff I'm learning about. And, you know, she was kind of like, oh, okay. You know, and the school that she was at, it's also a Christian school, I think, of the Wesleyan denomination. And so, you know, she would be kind of baffled at like how, like, oh, I go to this Christian school and I don't remember hearing about any of this, you know. And I also went to a Christian, you know, university for a time, and you know, there I didn't learn about anything like this, you know, like you know, the Old Testament was talked about, but you know, nothing of, I gotta be careful with words here too, I would say of like of Torah value, I'll say that, I guess.
Yeah.
Like seeing it as we do, you know, seeing it as something that's, you know, like important that we should be, you know, observing and being aware of, versus like, oh, that's for the Jews, or that was for a different time, you know, something like that.
So you you seem to have a very level head on your shoulders for a 24-year-old. You've obviously done a lot of research.
I kind of had to, you know, once it came to that point where I was, you know, kind of starting to learn more about like, oh, we shouldn't be doing this. And I also learned about the pagan traditions, you know, as I was, you know, searching things out, you know, and the whole like a Christmas tree thing, you know, like being like a phallic symbol, stuff like that. You know, when I first learned about that, you know, it was really eye-opening and just like, you know, so I just had this desire like, okay, I need to like find things out. And so, you know, concerning the word, you know, like growing up, and there's so many things I didn't hear about, you know, like I basically like, oh, it's my mission to read, you know, scripture cover to cover, you know, like in the general, you know, translation. And then, you know, after learning about the Father's name in that process, I was like, I need a different version of scripture, just because like seeing the, you know, the old titles, you know, just, you know, it just bugged me, you know, like having to substitute it mentally after a while. And so, yeah. And so, you know, I ended up getting, you know, a couple different versions of scripture with, you know, the names, you know, restored. And so, you know, I just love it. I just love that that there are people out there, you know, printing out scripture in that way. And so that was definitely really good to have. Yeah, before that, you know, I just, you know, went through a lot being a pastor's son alone, you know, just growing up having, you know, the expectations of the assembly being a pastor's son. So, you know, I would play that role, and, you know, in order to honor my dad, you know, even before I was like really, you know, Torah observant, I guess still, you know, like, you know, I love my parents, you know, and just try to respect them as much as I could growing up, you know, but I definitely did a lot of things I shouldn't have, a lot of experimenting, a lot of, you know, being secretly rebellious and, you know, partying and, you know, doing that kind of stuff. Remember my first year of college, you know, like I went to school and actually flunked out, you know, when I went to that Christian private university. You know, I was there for a year. And, you know, when I was there, it was my first time, you know, being alone and, you know, kind of independent. So I, you know, eventually got exposed to different things and partied, you know, like with the, because there's a bunch of rebellious pastor's kids there too. So, you know, it was the same, you know, event for most of us, just that exposure to all this new stuff. And basically just like went over my head. And, you know, so I just kind of, I feel like I went through this really humbling experience, you know, because my parents have spent, you know, some money to send me to school and, you know, I was there to be learning and stuff like that. And, you know, I kind of like basically failed them. So I came back home because that school's in San Diego. And so that's it's about a 3-hour drive from here. So, I came back home and, you know, was working and, you know, going to community college, you know, and so, you know, just, it was during that time, you know, I was starting to, you know, be pulled to, you know, Yahusha through this different, you know, avenue of like information that wasn't generally taught in, you know, the Christian, you know, body. And yeah, just went through all these different events, you know, and then looking back, I was like, wow, you know, he's been here the whole time, you know, and that was something that really just like fortified my belief and faith, you know, in him, and, you know, and continues to work through my life now. And just, you know, kind of have to develop this eye of seeing how he works. It's as if, you know, he is this, you know, amazing, huge, you know, creator, and, you know, he chooses to reveal himself in the most subtle of ways, you know. It's like, oh, I can't just be really flashy and be like, hi, here I am, you know, but, you know, the way that he, you know, like shows himself is through these like all these little very subtle ways. It's like, oh, do you see me, and, you know, once you're like, yeah, exactly, it's just like, oh, you're here, oh, I see, you know. And so it's I definitely didn't come to this mindset without lots of tempering, I guess, you know, like just living life and I'm just going through different, you know, situations. You know, I've had my share of heartache and you know, mistakes, just learning, you know, learning the hard way. But I'm thankful I have my life, you know, that he was able to teach me a while.
So you flunked out of college.
Yeah.
That's normal, mate. I flunked out of college, if you could call it college. My parents spent a fortune and sent me to the Australian Institute of Music. And I was signed up to do a 4-year Bachelor of Music. I would have come out with a Bachelor of Music, but I just couldn't go there in my mind. In my mind, I couldn't handle any kind of study or, you know, I'd come from a strict, you know, sheltered Christian school, and then I go out into this music industry, and there's just, you know, I was still Christian, and, you know, I just couldn't handle the secular world, and they're all just having their ideas and opinions, and the teachers are just like, you learn these 3 scales in the, by the morning, you know, and I'm like, oh, phew, get stuffed, you know. So then I dropped down to a diploma, which was a 2-year course, and then I eventually dropped down to a certificate, which was 1 year, and I didn't even finish that. So it was a total waste of time. And that's when I was working part-time in the salon with Chris and Victoria, and they said, basically, come get a real job, you know. You're not going to be a rock star. Come get a real job. And glad I did. So, but a life experience.
Yeah, wow.
Life's experiences, mate. Everybody comes to Yahusha in pieces, don't they?
Yeah. Seems to be that way.
Mm.
Yeah. Another thing too, I know, kind of I guess taboo subject sometimes is, you know, one of those that kind of brought me into, I guess it didn't bring me into belief, but I mentioned that I was exposed to like the pagan traditions, and the way that I was brought into that was this former boss of mine, you know, when I came back to LA, I was picking up different jobs, so I had this for a time, this frozen yogurt. I was working at a frozen yogurt shop, you know, basically like ice cream and fruit, you know, putting on. But I had this boss who, you know, I became close with, and he's like, "Oh, your family's Christian, right?" And I was like, "Yeah." And like, "Oh, they celebrate Christmas and stuff like that." Yeah. And so he gave me this book, and it was like this big book. The title of it was something like The Guide to the Global Conspiracy or something like that, you know? And so in there, it's just like, it's kind of touching on a bunch of different things, but, you know, it's talking about like religious conspiracy, stuff like that. And so one of the things they mentioned is like, oh, you know, it mentioned like pagan origins of, you know, Christianity for, you know, touch on different religions and stuff like that. But, you know, Christianity was one, I was within Christianity. So, you know, it mentioned, you know, like the whole thing with like, Christmas and also, you know, the bunny rabbit thing, also, you know, how those traditions started. And, you know, that was just really like, what, you know, and that was before learning anything about, you know, anything really substantial about like the names and Torah. So like that was a kind of a step before the Israelite heritage thing, you know, like in that main exposure to Torah. Yeah, I saw him kind of coming from, I still have that information, you know, in the back of my head too, like that kind of conspiracy outlook. And so once you're like second guessing everything that you've learned, you know, just really, I think that's, I don't know. I feel like that was the kind of like the breaking of my mind to like, hey, this world, you know, is probably not as it seems, you know, as you know, that first impression of it, you know, it may not be, you know, true to that. So, like, definitely, in pieces, you know, I relate to that.
So, how did you come across Fossilized?
I think the first time I came across that was like the articles. You know, I know Lou has some articles, you know, printed online, you know, regarding different subjects, and I think, you know, I was just doing like general Google searches on certain things. Once I, you know, was able to pick up different like keywords to look up, you know, the Sabbath was one thing for sure that I, you know, was, you know, picking different brains about, you know, and I think it was through that, looking at the articles, and then later on I found, you know, YouTube and YouTube videos, and I think at that time there weren't too many of the Torah Talk videos, you know, and so, you know, I know, so you guys were making more and going on. So I was like, oh, wow, you know, so I thought it was really interesting, you know. Yeah, I'm searching this stuff out, learning about it, and you guys are also, you know, talking about this stuff too. And so, So that was
you asked us, was it a year or so ago, you were asking us about engagement and marriage and things like that. Was that you?
Yeah, I believe so.
Yeah. Hope we answered your questions.
I mean, thank you guys for the feedback, you know. Because I have my what I believe and what I picked up from my, you know, reading through scripture, you know, like, you know, even now I may have gone through, like, you know, I've gone through scripture cover to cover, but you know how the word is, you know, you kind of have to keep absorbing it, keep reading, and, you know, it just seems like different points of your life, more comes out, different things, and you're like, wow, learning more. And, you know, the way Yahusha works, you know, he'll breathe life into the word and have it, like, jump out at you with whatever life situation you're in. And, yeah, but at the time, yeah, I remember asking about that and just, you know.
Mm. Yeah, because that's probably around the time you were trying to nail down your girl, eh?
Yeah.
Don't go.
Yeah. Like, I just, you know, I was kind of like, okay, am I doing the right thing? I wonder how other people have done this, you know. Especially since, Lauren, you know, like, I was kind of the main one giving her exposure to this alternative way to view scripture, you know. And, you know, and the more that I was, like, sharing with her, you know, like, it wasn't more so like, oh, hey, you know, believe this because I'd like you to, you know. Like, I came in to this way on my own through, you know, the Spirit, through the Ruach, you know, bringing me in. And so, you know, I definitely was very careful with, like, okay, I want the same thing for her, you know, or else it won't be real if it's, she's doing it for me, you know. And so, you know, and that's what's been happening. You know, I just share with her, and we read together, you know, we'll go on Skype and, you know, read scripture together. And, you know, so, and this, you know, the Ruach is coming in and breathing life. And so, you know, it's just really amazing, you know, to see that, okay, I'm not, you know, I'm not just out of my mind, just like, oh, you know, we should be, you know, observing the Sabbath, you know, like, and just really off the deep end or something, like, no, you know, like, you know, it's just people really are being, you know, regathered, and it's a real thing that's going on. And, you know, just, I don't, it's really bizarre how there's this, like, thick layer of kind of deception and just a tradition that has, like, covered up the true belief. But, you know, seeing it being slowly peeled away, and people all over the world, you know, being awakened to this, it's really, it's amazing. It's breathtaking. You know? It's,
certainly is.
Yeah. How's the recent, you know, I've seen a couple of the, like, off-the-cuff videos and, you know, talking with people in different places. You know, how's that going? Like, talking to other
families? It's going really well. We put up a the Day of Yahusha a couple of days ago. That was the Lou last weekend. Just trying to sort out a lot of the old documentaries I had to take offline, because when I was learning how to do video work, I just used to love using bits out of movies and stuff, because that's what professional documentaries do. They take bits off other things and they're allowed to, but I'm not. So so I took them all down.
Oh, yeah.
So I've got all this footage lying around now. So every few weeks I tie a Lou down. I say, look, we've got all this footage here. How about we put some live faces in it, so it breathes some meaning into it. Since I can't put movies in it anymore, we'll step into it and, you know, do something with it. And this branches will be very exciting, because so far the last three branches have all just been us Aussies. The whole point of the branches was to go global, and the first three episodes of branches has just all been, apart from Lou and Phyllis, has just been all Aussie people. So we're in LA today. It's very exciting.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I'm glad I could help out.
So, no, it's wonderful, mate. Anytime you want to get together, it's fine with me.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that'd be great. I know, you were saying?
As technology allows us.
Oh, yeah. I can see my video, like, kind of skipping around, freezing every once in a while.
That's fine. It's all right. Everyone knows it's Skype. They don't think we're sitting in the same room.
Okay, as long as they know, yeah, we're not. Oh yeah, I'm in Los Angeles.
I'm in Los Angeles. See the Hollywood sign? The Hollywood sign behind me. We're sitting on top of the Hollywood sign.
Oh, yeah.
No, we're not. Well, you're not even with a green screen, so that blew that anyway.
Yeah.
That's fine, mate. It's fine.
This would be kind of a strange background to have on the green screen.
Oh, it's lovely wallpaper. It's very autumn or spring.
Yeah.
So you're recording. You're in studio recording, or do you do it in bedroom, or how do you record?
Yeah, it's kind of bedroom matter. I mean, it's our buddy's living room, but he's got, you know, got a lot of expensive looking studio equipment that he's got us on, and you know, we really like the quality. You know, it's just been really it's really time consuming. It's been taking more time than we anticipated. You know, because we're looking to have like at least, you know, 13 songs on the album. You know, and they're all original. You know, and just we're hoping, you know, we can do good things with this, help us, you know, network and branch out to other, you know, musicians, and who knows what, you know, but, you know, I do, you know, hope that leads somewhere.
Well, I really like the quality. I think the quality is crystal clear. The guitar strings and the vocals is just really, very crisp. I like crisp.
I really record.
Nothing worse than hearing people. So it's the heart that counts. But when you hear music that sounds like people are playing it through a pillow, it's just like, oh dear.
Yeah.
Take the pillow away.
So working hard.
Yeah, we'll play some of your music on this video. Give people a bit of a sample.
Oh really? Oh, that's kind of. Okay.
What was that last song you had on SoundCloud that you were advertising on Facebook? I liked it. I forget the name of it. Something about waking up. Or people are asleep.
Dreamland.
Dreamland, yeah. That was a nice song.
Ah, yeah. I really enjoy that song.
Yeah. I'll find it. I'll play it in the end credits.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Feel free. Yeah, I mean, you know, the lyrics in there, that's one of those songs where, you know, it's talking, addressing like a sleeper, you know, hasn't this gone long enough, you know, you sleeping, you know, don't you want to wake up, you know, kind of thing.
Mm.
And, of course, you know, it has kind of multiple meanings, you know. It could be someone waking up to the knowledge that, you know, the world isn't as it seems, you know, generally speaking. Or also, you know, that can also go into the... kind of religious, spiritual realm too. That's kind of where it more so relates to me. You know, because I kind of woke up from, you know, just like being spoon-fed, you know, this doctrine, the spiritual, you know, this is a spiritual connection, you know, and, you know, if you're not, you know, kind of asking questions and just like, oh yes, everything that I'm being told is true, you know, it's kind of dangerous. Especially in these last days.
Yeah, I noticed on when you sent me those songs a few months ago on your Loves Yahusha site on SoundCloud. I thought, oh yeah, these are cool songs. And then I noticed you had another a separate site for your Amada Hush, and I thought, oh, maybe he does secular songs. But then when I started listening to the lyrics, I thought, ah, he's sneaky. He's got... Because when I heard that song, I thought... It wasn't until I heard the Dreamland one I thought, oh, wake up from your slumber. That sounds familiar. Beautiful. And it's it's the way to go, to reach the young people, to reach the generation. It's a very unique sound you've got, very very modern, contemporary. I like it. It's brilliant.
Thank you.
Mm. And you got to be subtle, because the minute they hear it, any sniff of religious stuff, they go, oh, get out of here, you know?
Yeah.
Been there, done that, you know. Yeah. Unfortunately, religion has given you sure a bad name, so
that's it.
You got to be really subtle, haven't you?
Yeah, I mean, you know, Animate, he's not so much for that. So, you know, if there's anything that was, you know, kind of, I guess, preachy, you know, he would call me on. He'd be like, oh, hey, you know. And of course, if there was anything that was kind of too secular, you know, I'd be like, oh, you know, that doesn't really, you know, I want to be able to make music where I feel comfortable, you know, being, you know, a branch of Yahusha, you know, being a secular band, I want to feel comfortable. So, you know, we've got a good relationship, you know, got good communication there, you know, regarding those. So
for all the people your age that might be watching this, what advice do you have for them? If they're watching this, you know, most people don't stumble across this sort of thing. If they're watching this, they're clearly either searching or they're believers or they're on their way or they're learning still. What advice do you have for them?
My advice would be to keep on, you know, like Yahusha is the way, the truth, and the life. And, you know, surely you can't go wrong. Continue to pursue him and everything that you do. And definitely, you know, like a Torah observance is important, you know, but like he said, ultimately we need to have that compassion, the right ruling. You know, we need to have that love. And, you know, that's something that, you know, I'm kind of a younger mind, but I'll see, you know, like kind of the older branches, the older Natsari, you know, kind of, you know, I see that attacking, like, oh, you know, you're not observing this way, you know, like you're going to be condemned for that or something like that, you know. And, you know, ultimately we are all covered under his blood. And, you know, I think it's really important to know that, you know, we're not all on the same level of knowledge, life situation, you know, certain things, you know, haven't exposed certain, I don't know, things of notions of truth, you know, cause I know with myself, you know, it was a very difficult thing coming out of the Christian belief and, you know, still having some of the stuff and then throwing away what I learned was untruth, you know, and then I still learned, oh, some of the stuff that I was holding, you know, still wasn't right for me to be holding. And so, you know, it was a learning experience. And so, you know, I say, you know, just don't be discouraged by you know, people trying to condemn you or judge you. Ultimately, you know, it's, if you're serving Yahusha in spirit and truth, you know, I think ultimately you can't go wrong. You just continue to pursue him. He will, you know, send his spirit to continue to, you know, just clean you up and, you know, he will teach you as you go. And so just want to give the word of encouragement just to keep going.
Hallelujah. We want to hear more happy songs, mate.
Oh, yeah.
That Twilight song stood out from all of them, mate. It's just ding, 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 ding. It's like you could have played that on a ukulele. It would have gone great.
Oh, I don't know how to play that.
Just real happy, real happy song. A lot of your other songs are deep and meaningful, and this one was just happy, happy, happy.
I haven't been writing too much, like, you know, on my own recently. You know, a lot of the wedding planning and then the studio stuff, you know, has been taking up, and then, you know, shows and stuff that's been taking up some of that time, which is unfortunate. Like, I shouldn't really use that as an excuse. But, you know, anytime I wrote those songs, I really felt like that, you know, yeah, I was just like encouraging me to do it, kind of inspiring me to. And so I kind of like to kind of leave it that way, you know, when those songs will come, then they will. But, you know, it's something that I love to do. I love, like, I love to write music more than, you know, playing music, or, you know, performing. I think writing is my favorite thing to do. And so, especially, you know, even before, you know, coming to Yahusha, I wrote songs even within the Christian denomination, you know. And I remember I wrote a song for the sun, for Yahusha, you know. But I wasn't using JSUS, but I was using different titles, you know. I think the song was called "O Prince of Peace." And so, you know, I was, you know, using different titles from, you know, "O Prince of Peace," "O Redeemer," things like that. You know, never using name. I wasn't, you know, opposed to the name at the time, but I just thought it was interesting that I was avoiding the name at that time, kind of. So,
being drawn.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, what's with this wedding thing? You got a big shindig happening soon, have you? Are the parents involved? Yeah. The parents happy? The parents happy about everything?
Yeah. Yeah, but I have trouble figuring out what to say when people sneeze now. Just, yeah. I'm like, oh, yeah, bless you. But then, you know, I read books on like the origin of the word bless. So, you know, I use like a Barak, you know, hallelujah scriptures. They have use that word, you know.
Well, I have lots of kids. So generally, when someone sneezes, it's cover your mouth.
Oh no, that seems a little rude.
You got all your parents involved. All the parents are happy and everything.
Yeah.
That's good.
Yeah, her family is from Ohio originally. You know, my family is actually from Barbados in the Caribbean. And
Barbados, woohoo!
Caribbean. Yeah.
Very tropical.
Yeah.
That's very.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Yeah. They moved out here a couple of years before I was born, and so my parents live here. So
my Caribbean mate. I can tell I got a Caribbean mate now. Fantastic.
Yeah. I mean, you know, I'm really Americanized, and I don't have much of that culture in me, but, you know, I know some things. You know.
Fantastic.
But her family came out to visit my family and meet them a couple months ago, within the past couple months. And, you know, and they seemed to hit it off. They had a great time making fun of us, like, bringing up all the childhood, you know, growing pains and just... You know, but it was good, you know, they had a good bonding experience. And so that was something that we were praying for, Lauren and I, just like, oh, we hope they mesh well, you know, because different cultures, you know, you know, you've seen Lauren, we're, you know, not the same color or anything, you know, but, you know, our love transcends that, of course.
Of course. Yeah, that'd be over here. No one cares, Danny. Over there, that'd be, is that still a big deal in America? Down here, it's not. Would you get a lot of flack for that?
I wouldn't say too much, not too much, because, you know, I've seen several, you know, interracial couples here and there, but even so, there still seems to be, you know, kind of some kind of like raising of nodes and just like, oh, you know, that's what you guys are doing. Like, you know, like just, it's not too great a vibe, but, you know, being so close to like a Hollywood, Beverly Hills area, I feel like there's a lot of people who are kind of, I don't know, they have some strange opinions about other people. And the way they do things, and, but generally, you know, it's fine. The area that I live in, I live really close to USC. So it's really big. Well, maybe you're familiar with them. USC, I'm not sure. But
is that a college? Here,
yeah. I'll show that.
Are you near to like places I've heard of, like? What have I heard of? I've heard of the Hollywood sign. I've heard of Rodeo Drive, Universal Studios. Are you near any of those places?
Yeah, actually, Rodeo Drive, on my way to work, I pass through there every day. Well, every day that I work. The Hollywood sign, you know, I could go there, you know. It's maybe a half-hour drive in traffic, you know,
It's not a big deal, is it?
No.
Yeah.
I mean, it's my favorite place to be, you know, right here, just because, you know, there's so many of the really, really wealthy people, you know, like, living in that area, especially when I drive through, like, Rodeo Drive, that area, you know, like, all these really expensive, you know, shops and stuff like that, you know, and you see, you know, the cars people are driving, you know, and just the wealth that's in this like small area. And then, you know, like I live in an area where it's, you know, not as, you know, wealthy an area. And, you know, it's just, this is within a 20-minute drive, you know, like driving around. And, you know, it's just really, it's kind of sickening to see how, you know, there's like so much wealth within like a community of people, it seems. And, you know, and then the people, you know, like struggling really bad just to survive elsewhere, you know, not too far from there. And, you know, so I'm really used to seeing, you know, like, a lot of like kind of snooty people. Sometimes they give you really like, yeah, like, you know, weird vibes, like, you know, just they see the way that you dress and just look past you like you're like you don't exist, you know, that kind of thing. But you know, I think I don't know. It's a mixture, a good experience, I guess.
It's just occurred to me. I know it really doesn't matter in the grand scheme of things, and not why we're getting together at all. But you live in Los Angeles, Hollywood. Do you run into famous people? Anybody I might know?
Yeah.
Do some name dropping for me.
Are you familiar with Vince Vaughn? Yes. I saw him, you know, I was hiking one time, you know, he goes the other way. I was hiking up going the other way. That was up in, you know, near the Hollywood Hills. Yeah, I've seen different, you know, like basketball players, you know, Staples Center is really close, you know, Kobe and people like that. Let's see. Most recent celebrity I saw was at the airport. I saw two of them. They're kind of older guys. I need to look up their names. But I know one of them. He was in The Guardian. I know their faces.
Kevin Costner.
I believe it was Kevin Costner. I believe it was him. Wow. So you remember that movie?
it's one of my curses. I have an encyclopedia of movies in my head.
Okay.
Even ones I haven't seen. So.
Oh, wow. Yeah. I saw him, you know.
Who was the other one?
Wearing glasses. What was that?
Who was the other one?
The other one is, I'm trying to think of a movie that he came out in. I feel like he came out in one of those films like Parent Trap or something like that. Kind of an older guy. But besides that,
Dennis Quaid?
I can't connect the face to name right now. But yeah, I'll see different celebrities here and there. Kim Kardashian, I remember being, there's this kind of like mall place called The Grove. Saw her there one time. You know, every once in a while, you know, you see, you know, famous people around. Mm. It is kind of bizarre, just like, you know, you see these people on billboards and stuff like that, commercials and stuff, and, you know, seeing them in person. It's just like, I like it. It's a good reminder, like, okay, yeah, you're human. You're just like anyone else, you know. It's nuts, the esteem that they get, just kind of, even the name, like celebrity, it's like, a person that's worthy of being celebrated, like maybe everyone is worthy of being celebrated, but you know, it's just kind of, you know, I've got a vice, you know, or more like a, you know, I've got a burning grief with Hollywood, but you know.
What did you say?
It's a temper. I have a problem with a burning grief with Hollywood, you know, just some of the, you know, it's I feel like it's a school and it teaches like some
sex, live stuff. Sex, not, drugs, and rock and roll.
Yeah.
Yeah, I understand.
I did want to talk about what's it? Messianic Hall of Shame.
Oh, yeah, sure.
Yeah, because this is something that I thought about, like, being on here. I'm pretty sure there's going to be, you know, brothers and sisters out there who are probably going to be like, cooperating or, I'm trying to think of the word. But, you know, being in cahoots with you know, fossilized in a way, you know, or like you and Lou, you know, like, you know, being in the community, you know. You know, I'll hear that, like, oh, you know, sometimes people send me videos, Messianic Hall of Shame, something like that, you know, because they'll see it on my Facebook or something, you know. And the way I see it, we're all one family. Even, you know, I live in a Christian home, you know. For me to be, you know, judgmental of you guys, it's the same to be judgmental of my family here, you know. And, you know, at first, I was really like, no, you guys are on Christianity, you guys are following pagan traditions, like, oh, don't touch me, you know, not to that extreme, but, you know, kind of still having that, you know, that way going on with me. And, you know, I think the reason why I was brought up in this experience was so that I would you know, just share the experience, like, hey, you know, even then, despite all the traditions, you know, like, they're still my brothers and sisters in spirit as well, you know, because they believe in the Messiah, you know, Yahusha. You know, they may call him something different, you know, but for those who generally have their heart, you know, because in my dad's assembly, you know, these are people that are my, like, external, I guess, extended family, you know, and, you know, because I don't really live near my aunts and uncles like that, you know, so they're kind of like my aunts and uncles, and, you know, these are people, like, I see their hearts, you know, and a lot of these people are, like, really trying to seek the Father, you know, through this avenue, and, you know, and so how can I, you know, judge them for that? You know, I'm not in a place to do that, and how can I, you know, just, you know, see them as, like, lepers and just, like, you know, not associate myself with them at all, you know? Like, I still, you know, I still love on them. You know, they may not want to hear everything that I believe, you know, or, like, I'll start to share, and they're like, oh no, okay, I don't really want to know, you know, like, you know, because of the change, you know, some of them have been in that belief for a while, so I feel like, you know, some people may not want to change because of that, you know, maybe it's a pride thing, or, you know, just because, oh, well, this is the way it's been done for so long, and, you know, I don't want to mess with it, you know, but I feel like definitely I've been given the lesson that I must share of, like, that we have to love even, you know, those who may not be Torah observant, but then still have, you know, the Son, you know, maybe it's our duty to be sharing with them, and, you know, like, maybe they'll make the choice not to listen to you or to take that information and not do anything with it. That's on them, you know, but, so, like, learning from that, you know, not judging them, you know, like, kind of a message to those out there who maybe, like, see the Messianic Hall of Shame, and, you know, like, I'm not judging the people who do that either, but, you know, I don't think it's really our place to be so concerned with, you know, our brothers and sisters, what they're doing. We need to be focused on, you know, the Father and Son first and foremost. And, you know, like, if there's someone you don't agree with what they're doing, what they're saying, like, maybe you don't have to listen to them, or you don't have to follow what they're doing. But I think, like, you know, just going into, let's say, like, your work, and, like, oh, you know, don't listen to this guy, he's evil, you know, and just, like, you know, like, calling you names, or just, you know, judging you, you know, that's not your role, you know, and that's something that bothers me, you know, so bad, and I kind of feel like, okay, some people might judge me for this too, like, oh, you know, you're on, you know, Mark's show, like, oh, you must be one of them, Messianic Hall of Shame, ego, you know.
The fact that there's a site called the Messianic Hall of Shame, before they put anybody on it, they're already wrong. So it's quite laughable.
Yeah, it's kind of.
It'd be like, I mean, some people have said, "Oh yeah, we've had trouble with what Lou does too, but we've decided not to judge him." I never even had a problem with it. I thought it was hilarious. It'd be like somebody coming into my work in the hairdressing salon and saying, the ladies on that hairdressing videotape there don't have enough clothes on. Or the, you know, and I'm like, that's the fashion industry. It's hairdressing. You know, half the models have skimpy clothes on. It's like someone coming into the club that you're singing in and going, what are you doing in here, Harry? You know, it's like, well, this is where I work. Yahusha's gonna bump me into some people, you know? It's like, mind your business. You know, you're doing what you're doing, I'm doing what I'm doing. You know, everybody's, if, you know, how many of us get to go up in the hills and, you know, meditate all day?
Yeah.
And if we were, what good, what use would we be?
Yeah.
So it's get a life, people.
Yeah.
Anyway.
I just want to touch on that a little bit.
Sorry?
Just want to touch on that a little bit.
Yeah. I think you emailed me a while back about that, all that, didn't you?
Yeah, about
the scriptures and everything, yeah, because I'm coming after them as well. Yeah. Hope it was helpful, the info. It's all about love, isn't it, mate?
Definitely. Mm. I mean, there's so few of us at this point, you know, like, something I wonder about is, is a, I don't know, does there have to be, you know, I know that interpretations of scripture, prophecy is, you know, is people, you know, believe different things, but I always wonder if once the 144,000 is awakened on the earth, is that when, you know, Yahusha will come? You know, like, I always wonder about that. So I kind of feel like I wonder if, like, oh, maybe there's not 144,000, you know, people that, you know, call on his name and are seeking, you know, or, you know, observing Torah as best as he can, you know. Like, I wonder if that, you know, accounts for the 144,000, because, like, surely if Christianity, you know, was, like, the way, like, surely there's more than that. Like, there's has to be at least, you know, I know there's millions of people that are within Christianity, so, I, you know, I don't know if that's, you know, the most precise interpretation of the prophecy, but I always wonder about that. You
know? Well, Lou's often a fan of just if it says it, that's what it is. So instead of reading too far into things, and I think, well, it could be that number or it could be a symbolic number, but either way, in a world that's now heading towards 7 billion, 144,000 isn't a lot. So,
yeah.
So, and I don't think there'd be 144,000 Natsarim. That's just my opinion, but at this stage, that I've heard of, or that, you know, I don't think there'd be 144,000. You know.
Oh, so you don't think we're at that number?
I don't think so. Well, that's the remnant anyway. That's the first resurrection. You know, there's a lot of people who'll make it in the end, but weren't
the
second resurrection. A lot of people in the Book of Life, but as far as the remnant, the 144,000, they're people that are sealed with his name. So I think, well, my guess would be, I don't think there's 144,000 yet.
Yeah. That's my guess too. I'm just curious what you think. That's all wild to me, though, despite how many people there are on this planet. You know, I see it's like popping up here and there as time goes on, more and more people, you know, waking up to it. So it's nice. It's nice to see that, you know, other people are also seeing these things, you know.
Yeah. Wonderful. I love you, brother.
Love you too, man. It's so great to, like,
yeah,
talk to you, not just typing, you know, now, and just, you know, it's a little more real. This is
If after we take the children around Australia, if we can afford to, and if we can make money on the road, and we can save up, we really want to come home to America and visit all our friends over there. So when we come to America, you and I are going to jam.
Yeah, that would be awesome. I'd love to jam.
I'll have to lose a bit of weight, I think. I won't be able to come into those clubs of yours. Who's this old bugger? Can't come into this club. Yeah.
Julie be fine.
That'll be great, just to meet you and the missus. So you planning to buy a place or live somewhere, or what's the plan when you get married?
Yeah, we've already we've got an apartment in mind. Already got chosen out and talked to the landlords. They're actually because they have some apartments that are attached to the house that we're in now, and so we're renting that out. And you know, Lauren and I both don't want to stay in LA and have this be our permanent, you know, place, raising children and whatnot. You know, I know, like, one of her dreams is to live, like, in Africa, you know, because she's been there before, and, you know, live with, like, some tribes for a time, you know, like a mission trips, things like that. And she just loves how, you know, they live with more of their necessities versus, like, here in America, we have all this extra stuff. And, you know, people complain about, like, oh, I can't get by, you know, but you have shelter and you have food and you have water. And some people, like, struggle to have those things. And so, like, you know, of course it's his plan, you know, what he wills for us. We're not trying to, you know, have our roots go too deep here in LA.
Come and visit Australia, mate. You'll love it.
I would love to. That'd
surrounded
be great,
by water. Oh, well, you're on the water anyway, but.
Oh yeah, really close. So. Yeah. I mean, I've been to Barbados before, so I imagine maybe it's similar to that. Yeah.
Where have you been?
Oh, Barbados.
Barbados, yeah.
But imagine Australia's is significantly larger than the island. So.
Well, I thought Australia was much smaller than America, but then I looked at it the other day, and I think it fits almost the same width as the United States, America. Same width.
Oh.
So if you had to drive from one side to the other, it would be almost the same. I think.
Okay, so, I did not know that.
It's not as tall, and but it's the same width. Similar width.
So where are you? Like, are you kind of western?
We're sort of east, southeast, Sydney.
Okay.
Harbour Bridge, mate.
I obviously have not been studying my map, maps and where right. people are.
Yeah, that's all right.
Nice. Yeah. What's the general weather like there?
It's different everywhere in Australia, but here it's horrible. It's stinking hot, pouring with rain, freezing cold, all in the one day. So you don't know how to dress. You gotta wear three layers and then take them all off and put them all back on again.
Sounds horrible.
The seasons are all out of whack down here. Up north, it's lovely. Where Chris and Victoria and all my other mates live, they live up all up there. It's lovely, tropical, So. They reckon it's cold, but we didn't have any winter clothes up there, so it's not cold. It's lovely. It's tropical. It's paradise up there. So.
Wow.
Yeah.
Any plans on moving?
Well, yeah. We're going to hit the road. And if we had to put roots down again, if we wanted to put roots down again, it'd definitely be up north. Up with them. Because it's very important to have people around you, that family, I guess. Family that in agreement.
I mean, I'm struggling just to connect through, internet means. I think I met one person. It was really exciting too, but I've got a little motor scooter, and so there's some guys at the scooter shop there, 7-day Adventist, we have that common ground, okay, Sabbath, maybe when they observe it is kind of different, whatever. But still, it's something. So there's a guy that I met through the guys at the mechanics at the scooter shop. I remember we were having a conversation, just messianic was the theme, in general. And then he says, something, something, Yahuwah. And I was just like, what? I was like, you use the name. And he was like, you know the name too? And, it was just like, oh, wow. The other two guys are just kind of like, what's going on with these guys? We were just, so I met one other, Natsari who, knew of the name and stuff. And so that was really, that was just like, it was so, I don't know, the feeling was just,
yeah,
it was wonderful. It's wonderful.
Very refreshing.
Yeah. I think he's the only person I've met in real life like that where, something like that happened. Lauren and I, we use, of course, the names together, just learning together, I don't even see her face to face, in person very often, it'll be once a month or every other month that we get to go and visit each other. Most of my family is really internet, it's kind of distant connection. But
well, something. Anytime you want to chat, mate, with your fingers or on Skype, always available.
Yeah, I gotta get a clock so I know what time it is over there, with my time.
Because that's interesting, our little brain. Yeah, I don't believe it. We had a little brainstorm session there, didn't we? 144,000. What does that mean? Gee, that's good. I don't get too many brainstorm sessions on here.
Oh.
It's lovely.
Yeah, see, like, this kind of stuff, I can't bounce this stuff off.
Another show. Harry's on. Brainstorming.
Yeah.
Brainstorming with Harry. Yeah. That's great, man. Well, it's getting late here, so I'm going to get off of this.
Right.
And you reckon your mum's coming into the office soon, is she?
Yeah. So I don't know. I'm glad we were able to meet, you know, a while before that, so we had plenty of time just to talk soon.
Yeah.
It's definitely really refreshing being able to talk to you. So thank you for, you know, like, reaching out when to do this, despite all the trouble with me alarm clocks.
No trouble, mate. Maybe next time we'll find a time where it's not as early for you.
I mean, I don't mind this. You know, this is fine.
Because I thought, early morning, he's a musician. He gigs at night. That's going to be hard.
I mean, the gigs aren't as often. You know, it's not always, you know, the same thing. And I like to get my sleep most of the time, so I can, you know, plan accordingly. And,
Well, it's a pleasure meeting you face-to-face, mate. And I'm sure everybody's encouraged to meet another brother. Another brother from a different mother.
Yeah. I feel the love still, you know, like, thank you again.
Yeah, it's a pleasure, mate. You enjoy your day, eh?
Thank you. Enjoy your night. Sleep well.
We'll be in touch. Email, Facebook, all the mediums.
Yeah.
Love you, mate.
Love you, too.
We'll see you later. Yeah.
Prosthetic of all, no more I see clear. Dreamland, wash away. Take back each day that you stole from me. Dreamland, wash away. Take back each day that you stole from me. Dreamland, wash you. Dreamland, wash you away. go for me.